We now start module 2 of chapter 1. The title is Stereographic Projection. In this module, we first discuss Euler's formula. Then we will find the nth root of unity, and so that these roots represent n vertices of a regular polygon of n sides inscribed in a circle having center at origin and radius 1. Then we introduce a symbol infinity called point at infinity in the complex plane. The inclusion of this symbol together with complex plane C results extended complex plane. After that, we establish a 1-1 mapping from the extended complex plane to the unit sphere called Riemann sphere, and the mapping is called stereographic projection. At last, we will provide some example relevant to this module. So we first discuss Euler's formula. By assuming that the infinite series expansion of e to the power x, that is equal to 1 plus x plus x square by factorial 2 plus x cube by factorial 3 plus etc. of elementary calculus holds when x equal to I theta, we can arrive at e to the power I theta is equal to 1 plus I theta plus I theta whole square by factorial 2 plus I theta whole cube by factorial 3 plus etc. And that is equal to 1 minus theta square by factorial 2 plus theta 4 by factorial 4 minus etc. plus I into theta minus theta cube by factorial 3 plus theta 5 by factorial 5 minus etc. That is, we write e to the power I theta is equal to cos theta plus I sin theta. And this formula is called Euler's formula. So now we can define e to the power z as equal to e to the power x plus iy equal to e to the power x into e to the power iy, and that is, we write e to the power x into cos y plus I sin y. Now we discuss nth root of unity. The solutions of the equation z to the power n equal to 1, where n is a positive integer, are called the nth root of unity and are given by z to the power n equal to 1, that is equal to cos 0 plus I sin 0, that is equal to cos 2k pi plus I sin 2k pi. So using de Moivre's theorem, we can write z equal to cos 2k pi by n plus I sin 2k pi by n, that is equal to e to the power 2k pi I by n, where k is 0, 1, 2 up to n minus 1. If we assume that omega equal to cos 2 pi by n plus I sin 2 pi by n, that is equal to e to the power 2 pi I by n, the n roots are 1, omega, omega square, up to omega n minus 1. Therefore, geometrically they represent the n vertices of a regular polygon of n sides inscribed in a circle of radius 1 having center at the origin. The circle has the equation mod z equal to 1 and is often called the unit circle. So now we introduce a symbol infinity called point at infinity. The linear transformation z to w where W is equal to fz and fz equal to lambda z plus mu, where lambda is non-zero constant and mu is any constant, is a one-on-one mapping of the finite complex plane onto itself. But this is not true for the case of inversion map, that is for z tends to W, where W equal to 1 by z. If we write in polar form, we have z equal to r e to the power I theta and omega equal to rho e to the power I phi, where rho equal to 1 by r. Therefore, we see that the points close to the origin in the z plane, that is r is near to 0, are mapped onto points far away from the origin in the W plane. All the points inside a disk of small radius epsilon in the z plane are mapped onto points outside a disk of large radius 1 by epsilon in the W plane. As epsilon tends to 0, the disk in the z plane shrinks to the origin and there is no image of z equal to 0 in the W plane. Similarly, as the point z moves further and further away from the origin, its image in the W plane moves closer and closer to the origin in the W plane. But there is no point in the z plane which can be assigned W equal to 0 as the image under this inversion. It turns out to be useful to introduce the concept of a point at infinity or z equal to infinity as a formal image of z equal to 0 under the inversion map W equal to 1 by z. The point z equal to 0 can then be regarded as the image of the point at infinity. The use of z equal to infinity will always be understood in terms of a limiting process W tends to 0, where W is 1 by z. To examine the behavior of a function fz at z equal to infinity, it suffices to let z equal to 1 by W and examine the behavior of the function f 1 by W at W equal to 0. As for example, we say that the function fz equal to 2z minus 1 by z minus 3 tends to 2 as z tends to infinity, because f of 1 by W is equal to 2 minus W by 1 minus 3 by W, and which tends to 2 at W tends to 0. Now we introduce extended complex plane. By the extended complex number system, we shall mean the complex plane C together with a symbol infinity which satisfies the following properties. Number one, if z is any complex number, finite, then z plus infinity equal to infinity, z minus infinity equal to infinity, and z by infinity is equal to 0. Number two, if z is any non-zero complex number, then z into infinity gives the result infinity, and z by 0 gives the result infinity. Number three, infinity plus infinity equal to infinity into infinity equal to infinity. Number four, if z is any finite complex number, then infinity by z gives infinity. The set C union point infinity is called the extended complex plane and is denoted by C infinity. The nature of argon plane at the point at infinity is made much clearer by the use of Riemann's spherical representation of complex numbers, which depends on stereographic projection. Now we discuss Riemann's spherical representation of complex numbers. It is nothing but a mapping from the extended complex plane onto the unit sphere. The sphere is the tangent to the plane at z equal to 0. The sphere is called Riemann sphere, and the mapping is called stereographic projection. After that, we will provide an example in support of stereographic projection. So we now discuss stereographic projection. We consider the argon plane C and a unit sphere S cap tangent to C at z equal to 0. The diameter NS is perpendicular to C, and we call the points N as north pole and S as south pole of S cap respectively. Now we establish a 1-1 correspondence between the points on the sphere and the points on the plane. To each point capital A in the plane, there corresponds a unique point A dashed on the sphere. The point A dashed is the point where the line joining A to the north pole N intersects the sphere. Conversely, corresponding to each point A dashed on the sphere except the north pole, there exists a unique point A in the plane. By defining that the north pole N corresponds to the point at infinity, we can say that there exists a 1-1 correspondence between the points on the sphere and the points in the extended complex plane. This sphere is known as Riemann sphere, and the correspondence is known as stereographic projection. For this, see figure 1.1, and this is our figure 1.1. Here C is the complex plane, S cap is the unit sphere which is tangent to the plane at z equal to 0. N is the north pole, S is the south pole. Corresponding to any point A, we join line NA. It intersects the sphere at A dashed. So in such a way, we can establish a 1-1 mapping from the plane onto the sphere. As for example, we consider the sphere as x1 square plus x2 square plus x3 square equal to 1. The plane of projection we take as x3 equal to 0, and let 0, 0, 1 be the coordinate of N. For any point A dashed whose coordinate is x1, x2, x3 on the sphere, we have point A whose coordinate is x, y, 0 in the x3 plane, where the line N A dashed meets the plane of projection. Obviously, the points 0, 0, 1, x1, x2, x3 and the point xy0 are collinear, and then the equation of the line is x1 by x equal to x2 by y equal to x3 minus 1 by minus 1. from this by solving we get x equal to x1 by 1 minus x3 and y equal to x2 by 1 minus x3. Therefore, we get z equal to x plus I y, that is equal to x 1 plus I x 2 by 1 minus x 3. From this we get modulus z square is equal to x 1 square plus x 2 square by 1 minus x 3 whole square, and that is equal to 1 plus x 3 by 1 minus x 3. And hence we get x 3 equal to mod z square minus 1 divided by mod z square plus 1. Also we see that z plus z bar by mod z square plus 1 is equal to x 1, and z minus z bar divided by I into mod z square plus 1 is equal to x 2. In this way we can establish an 1-1 correspondence between the points in the extended complex plane and the points on the sphere. Now example, find all the roots of the equation z to the power 4 minus 1 minus z whole to the power 4 is equal to 0. So solution, we assume that w is equal to z by 1 minus z. Then the given equation becomes w 4 is equal to 1, and we know 1 is equal to cos 0 plus I sin 0. That is, we can write cos 2 k pi plus I sin 2 k pi, where k is an integer. Therefore, by de Moivre's theorem, we can write w equal to cos 2 k pi by 4 plus I sin 2 k pi by 4, where k is 0, 1, 2, and 3. Again, from w equal to z by 1 minus z, we get z equal to w by w plus 1. And therefore, z is equal to cos 2 k pi by 4 plus I sin 2 k pi by 4 divided by cos 2 k pi by 4 plus I sin 2 k pi by 4 plus 1. That is equal to e to the power 2 k pi I by 4 by e to the power 2 k pi I by 4 plus 1. Now putting k equal to 0, 1, 2 and 3, we obtain all the 4 roots of the given equation. Another example, find all the values of z for which z to the power 5 equal to 32, and locate these values in the argon plane. So we have z to the power 5 equal to 32. That means 32 into cos 2 k pi plus I sin 2 k pi, where k is any integer. So this gives by de Moivre's theorem z equal to 2 cos 2 k pi by 5 plus I sin 2 k pi by 5, where k varies from 0 to 4. So if we put k equal to 0, then we obtain z equal to z1, that is equal to twice cos 0 plus I sin 0, and that is equal to 2. If we put k equal to 1, then we obtain z equal to z2, that is equal to twice cos 2 pi by 5 plus I sin 2 pi by 5. Putting k equal to 2, we obtain z equal to z 3 equal to twice cos 4 pi by 5 plus I sin 4 pi by 5. If k is equal to 3, then we get z equal to z 4, that is equal to twice cos 6 pi by 5 plus I sin 6 pi by 5. If k equal to 4, then we obtain z equal to z 5, and that is equal to twice cos 8 pi by 5 plus I sin 8 pi by 5. So these are the only roots of the given equation. The values of z are indicated in the next figure. Note that they are equally spaced along the circumference of a circle having center at origin and radius 2. Another way of saying that the roots are represented by the vertices of a regular polygon. So this is the figure. Here you see z1 lies on real axis and z2, the amplitude of z2 is 2 pi by 5. Amplitude of z3 is 4 pi by 5. Amplitude of z4 is 6 pi by 5 and of z5 is 8 pi by 5. So from this we can say that they are equally spaced and they represent a vertices of a regular polygon inscribed in a circle having center origin and radius 2. So now we start another example. Find all the roots of minus 8, minus 8 root 3 I whole 1 by 4 and exhibit them geometrically. So here minus 8, minus 8 root 3 I whole 1 by 4. We can write this as 16 into cos 2k pi plus 4 pi by 3 plus I sin 2k pi plus 4 pi by 3 whole 1 by 4. That is, we write 2 into cos 2k pi plus 4 pi by 3 by 4 plus I sin 2k pi plus 4 pi by 3 by 4, where k varies from 0 to 3. Therefore, putting the values of k, that is 0, 1, 2 and 3, we can get 4 roots, which are z1 equal to twice cos pi by 3 plus I sin pi by 3, z2 equal to twice cos 5 pi by 6 plus I sin 5 pi by 6, z3 equal to twice cos 4 pi by 3 plus I sin 4 pi by 3. And putting k equal to 3, we get another root z4 equal to twice cos pi by 6 minus I sin pi by 6. That is, the roots are 1 plus I root 3 minus root 3 plus I minus 1 minus I root 3 and root 3 minus I. Clearly, the roots lie at the vertices of a square inscribed in a circle of radius 2. Center at the origin. Also, they are equally spaced with difference of angle as pi by 2. So this is our figure. You note that z1, the argument of z1 is pi by 3, argument of z2 is 5 pi by 6, argument of z3 is 4 pi by 3, and argument of z4 is 11 pi by 6. So clearly the difference of angles is pi by 2. And z1, z2, z3, z4 represents the vertices of a square inscribed in a circle having center at origin and radius 2. So next example, establish the relation n by 2 to the power n minus 1 is equal to product k equal to 1 to n minus 1 sin k pi by n, where n greater equal to 2 is an integer. So suppose that 1, rho 1, rho 2 up to rho n minus 1 be the n roots of unity, where rho k equal to e to the power 2 k pi I by n, and k varies from 1, 2 up to n minus 1. Then we can write z to the power n minus 1 as equal to z minus 1, z minus rho 1 into z minus rho 2 up to z minus rho n. So dividing both sides by z minus 1, we get z to the power n minus 1 by z minus 1 equal to z minus rho 1 into z minus rho 2 into up to z minus rho n. So letting z tends to 1 from both sides, we obtain n equal to 1 minus rho 1 into 1 minus rho 2 up to 1 minus rho n minus 1. So now we take conjugate of both sides, and then we get n equal to 1 minus rho 1 conjugate into 1 minus rho 2 conjugate up to 1 minus rho n minus 1 conjugate. So therefore, multiplying the above 2, we get n square equal to product k varies from 1 to n minus 1, 1 minus rho k into 1 minus rho k conjugate. That is equal to product 1 minus e to the power 2 k pi I by n into 1 minus e to the power minus 2 k pi I by n, where k varies from 1 to n minus 1. That is equal to product twice 1 minus cos 2 k pi by n, where k is 1 to n minus 1. That is, we can write product k equal to 1 to n minus 1, 4 sin square k pi by n, and that is equal to 2 to the power 2 into n minus 1 product sin square k pi by n, where k varies from 1 to n minus 1. Now taking the non-negative square roots from both sides, we obtain the required result. At the end of this module, we came to know the Euler's formula, the nth roots of unity and their geometric behavior, the concept of point at infinity, extended complex plane, and a one-one mapping from extended complex plane to the unit sphere called stereographic projection. We also discussed some relevant problems. For more problems, you can see self-assessment part. Also, you can consult any reference books. This ends module 2 of chapter 1.